know very well, better than we would like, frustration with technology. I mean, we had some of it yesterday, right? We couldn't, some of us couldn't hear Jahansiv, even though she was in Mumbai and the thrill of that. But if you can't hear her, it's frustrating, or you don't really know whether you're going to get online or not, etc. I think what makes technology at its best is when you really barely know it's there. You know, when you can flick this on and have people from all over the world joining us. When Cindy is recording this and we're going to archive what we've been doing and edit it into some things will be YouTubes that will be available out in the world, and some will be more specific teaching materials. And it's unobtrusive. It's there to augment. It's there to document. It's there to sort of make whatever you're seeing better, not to distract from it. David, to me, you kind of represent people who really don't trust technology, or haven't in the past trusted it, let's say. Who haven't.
And what about yesterday?
And I think when we were exchanging recently, and I said to Dave, well, what do we think of it like there's a counter story. There's a story of technology as the problem story, and then there's a counter story of technology as creating a collaboratory. I didn't invent that term. It's really, it's ways of using technology, really, to bring people together in a project with shared discovery. And I thought, yeah, we're creating a collaboratory. That's what we'll do. So when I was teaching in university or graduate students, I taught a bit of psychology students at Middlebury College, and then I taught at Smith with their MSW program, and at University of Vermont with their MSW program. And that was right when discussion forums were first coming out. And we would talk about meeting in the corridors. Like, you know, if we're not able to meet, like with graduate students, with a hybrid program or an online program, and rather than meeting in the corridors between classes, you set up the discussion forum and you can meet and you can structure it in ways that people can really come together and have conversations in private ways that extend the conversation. Mm-hmm. And out of that point, I did that, I don't remember how many years, but close to 10 years, I decided I wrote a book about it, Reauthoring Teaching, because I was really interested in ways of teaching that are built around similar guiding principles and ethics as the actual practice. I remember sitting with Michael in one of these cottages the October before he died, and he held the manuscript on his lap, and that was very meaningful to me. And then he died just 6 weeks or something before it was actually published. And in the very end, there was the question, oh, I need a website. What do I call it? Mm-hmm. And I was like, Reauthoring Teaching, Creating a Collaboratory. That just kept building. Like, I kept getting a website together. I'd hear about someone else that could help me to do that. And then it would crash. And then you think, oh, I got to get a better one, got to get a better one. And then finally, I got someone who could really help. Sarah Lenz, who said right from the start, build it with, create a map of what it's going to look like, what the functions are, and let's get it on a really solid foundation. And so that's what we've done, I think, in the construction of this community, this virtual community. Higher education was something that was really, we need to build some more resources and materials, and also a network of people who teach. It feels like a dream come true to have, you know, you all here. And for me, it truly is a labor of love, and also a commitment that if we're going to have narrative therapy be there in the future, that these are things we need to attend to, and not attend to alone, but together. But I really want this to be really honoring the legacy of both Michael and David, and showing what's possible as we move into future generations. Thank you.